Hi, I'm in a band, and much like in calculus, I'm about to push my vocal cords to their absolute limit. With thousands of roaring fans in attendance, I'm about to hit the highest high note of my entire life. You could even say it's the limit of my vocal cords. Push it to the limit. Yeah! Don't worry, this isn't a real band. You'll never have to hear that high note ever again. And trust me, I don't want to either. Welcome to Limits Introduction, and welcome to calculus. This is the first thing you learn in calculus, so I'm going to write it down up here just so you remember what you're learning. We are learning the very basics of limits today. Limits are the fundamental building block of all of calculus. And even after this lesson, that may sound a little bit weird, but as you get further in calculus, this will make more and more sense. Let's start with an example problem. A train is leaving Gotham City because, let's be honest here, who would want to live in Gotham City, right? At 54 miles per hour. And we want to figure out, how far will that train go in 3.2 hours? Now you may be looking at this question and thinking, yeah, that's really easy. And you'd be right, it is a really easy question. All we have to do is multiply 54 times 3.2. 54 miles times 3.2 hours. When we multiply 54 times 3.2, our answer comes out to be 172.8 miles in the allotted 3.2 hours. So why do I bring up this example? This is clearly not a calculus problem. Well, I want to bring up the idea of the limit. This is the farthest the train can go going 54 miles an hour in 3.2 hours. This is not how far it will go. It's not a guarantee. Like, what happens if our train here, you know, he's going along the track and boom, he gets blown up by some bandits or something. That could be a problem, right? What if the train gets off to a really slow start? It doesn't start on time. Maybe somebody's late. Maybe the conductor fell asleep at the wheel. I don't know. Regardless, we're not guaranteed to go the full 172.8 miles. And that's where the idea of the limit comes in. Let me explain. Let's use a function we all know. We're gonna use the function y equals x squared. We all know what that looks like, right? We have our graph here. And let me take this green pen. It looks something like this, that, and that. It's an even curve on both sides. So here's the question. What is the limit as x approaches 2 of x squared? Now, since you're new to calculus and watching this video, you may not know what that answer is. And trust me, I didn't know what it was either. This stuff was very confusing when I first learned it, and I want to make it simple. Well, it turns out this answer is actually pretty easy to get to. All we have to do is figure out what our function equals at x equals 2. So this is x equals 2 along the x-axis. What does our y value equal? If x equals 2, what does our y value equal? We can find that simply by plugging in 2 into our function. So y is equal to 2 squared, which is equal to 4. So the limit as x approaches 2 of x squared is just equal to 4. Pretty easy, right? This is the basic idea of limits. Essentially, we want to figure out what happens when we get really close to a certain point on our function. As our function gets closer and closer to equaling x equals 2, our function gets closer and closer to equaling y equals 4. That is the basic idea of limits and what we will be basing the rest of calculus on. It may sound crazy that such a simple concept is what calculus is based on, but trust me, it makes more sense as we get further along. For today, we're just gonna work with simple limit problems like this one. Let's try something a little bit more difficult. Here we have the function f of x, remember that's basically the same thing as y, is equal to sine of x divided by x. And we wanna find the limit as x approaches, that's what this arrow means, approaches 0. So we could try what we did before. We could plug in 0 to our function, and we get sine of 0 divided by, ooh, that could be a problem. We can't divide by 0. That's not allowed. Imagine trying to show off a collection to 0 people. How do you even, like, divvy that up? You can't. There's nobody to show it to. We cannot divide by 0. So how do we solve this problem? Good question. Well, what we can do is draw the graph of this problem. The graph looks like this. So our sine function, it goes whoop and hits this spot here and goes back down and repeats like that forever. You may notice here at x equals 0, we have a hole in our function. This hole means that we don't actually have something that exists at x equals 0. But you may remember a key word in something I said earlier. We don't care what happens when we actually reach x equals 0. We just care what happens as we approach x equals 0. So as our line gets closer and closer to equaling x equals 0, what does our y value equal? Well, we can figure this out by plugging in numbers that are very close to 0 to our function. So let's try something such as sine of 0.001 divided by 0.001. Now, as you can see, we're not dividing by zero anymore, which means this function is valid. We can figure out what that equals. And this is extremely close to equaling one. So the limit as x approaches zero of our function sine of x divided by x is equal to one. See, not too bad. And it's even easy to see visually. Before we go too much further, I do want to talk about limit notation because there's a certain way you're supposed to write down these problems and I haven't been doing that so far. So here's limit notation. We write L-I-M, that stands for limit, and then right underneath that we write x, or whatever variable we're using. It could be z, it could be y, it could be, I don't know, a Greek letter like alpha or something, I don't know. It could be anything. Write an arrow, that stands for approaches. The limit as x approaches, and then our c, which is just some constant number, such as 0.5, 2, 69, 387.2, whatever you want. And then here we'll write our function. Remember, f of x is just a function. So this is read as the limit as x approaches c of our function. And that all equals big C, which is just whatever our limit is. Using the example we just did, the limit as x approaches zero of sine of x divided by x is equal to one. Let me read that again for you. The limit as x approaches zero of sine of x divided by x is equal to one. Let's do another limit problem, but this time the graph is going to be very hard to visualize. Here's the limit we want to find. We want to find the limit as x approaches negative two of x squared plus x minus two divided by x plus two. What is the limit? So the first thing you may notice is if we were to just plug in x for all these numbers, we get negative 2 plus 2, which is 0. Once again, still can't divide by 0. That hasn't changed in the last 3 minutes. And also, this graph is not easy to visualize. I don't know what this looks like. I know you don't know what this looks like. So what we're going to do is we're going to implement the strategy we used earlier. We're going to plug in a lot of numbers that are very close to negative 2 and see what happens. Over here, I'm going to draw a little chart of what numbers we used and what limit we got. So we're going to write our x, whatever we plugged in, and our f of x, whatever the output is. First, we're going to try negative 2.3. We're going to try that first. So if we plug in x is equal to negative 2.3, all we have to do is replace every x in here with negative 2.3. So this will equal negative 2.3 squared plus a negative 2.3 minus 2 divided by negative 2.3 plus 2. I'm not going to do all the simplification here, but what this ends up equaling is negative 3.3. So let's write that down over here, negative 3.3. Next, let's try something even closer to negative 2, such as x equals negative 2.1. Let's do the same process, negative 2.1 squared plus a negative 2.1 minus 2 is equal to negative 2.1 plus 2. Once again, I'm not going to show the simplification, but this is equal to negative 3.1. You may notice that we're approaching a number, but we're going to check a couple more things first. So I'm going to write it down in our little graph here, negative 2.1, negative 3.1. Okay, let's plug in something extremely close to negative 2, such as negative 2.001. That's pretty close to being negative 2, but it's not, so we won't end up dividing by 0. Plugging in x equals negative 2.001, we get negative 2.001 squared plus a negative 2.001 minus 2 all divided by negative 2.001 plus 2. And you may be noticing a pattern here. This is going to equal a negative 3.001. Let's write it down over here. Negative 3.001. You might have an idea of what our limit is, but we're going to try one more number. We're going to try something slightly bigger than negative 2. We're going to try negative 1.997. That's slightly above negative 2, but once again, we will not divide by 0. So let's try that. X equals negative 1.997. Plugging this in, we get negative 1.997 squared plus a negative 1.997 minus 2 divided by negative 1.997 plus 2. Once again, not going to do the simplification for this fraction, but this ends up equaling negative 2.997. 2.997. -2.997. I think you guys may have noticed a pattern. We're getting closer and closer to -3 every time we get closer and closer to -2. So because we're getting closer and closer to -3, the limit as x approaches -2 of x squared plus x minus 2 divided by x plus 2 is equal to -3. Boom, easy. That's not hard at all. Before we end this video, I want to show you one more thing with limits. What we're gonna do is we're gonna look at a limit, and we're not even gonna have a function. We're not gonna have an f of x equals x squared or anything like that. We're only gonna have a graph, and we're gonna solve that limit. So this graph is a piecewise function. Remember, a piecewise function is two functions kinda smushed together. So in this example, we have this, and we have this. And there's two points of interest for us. We have the point down here, 0, -2, and the point up here, 0, 2. Both of these functions are extending to negative infinity and infinity, respectively. What is the limit as x approaches 0 of our piecewise function here? What we're gonna learn about here is the left and right side limits rule. The left and right side limit rule. What this says is that we need to find two different limits. In order for a limit to exist in the first place, the limit coming from the left side and the limit coming from the right side have to be the same. So what we're gonna do here is actually find two limits. So we're gonna denote this as limits as x approaches 0 from the positive side, in other words, coming from there to there, and limits as x approaches 0 from the negative side, in other words, here to there. And since we have a graph, it actually is pretty easy to find both of these limits. Let's start with coming from the positive side. We start at infinity and approach 0. So here's x equals 0 along this line. And as we approach from negative infinity all the way to 0, as x gets closer and closer to equaling 0, our y gets closer and closer to equaling 2. This is a constant function. Now let's do it from the negative side. Starting at negative infinity, coming closer and closer to x equals 0, as we get closer and closer, our y gets closer and closer to equaling -2. Now remember what I said earlier. The left and right side limits have to be the same in order for the limit to exist. So, does 2 equal -2? No, of course not. They're not the same number at all. So, the answer to this question is not an answer at all. The answer is that the limit as x approaches 0 of this function we wrote up here does not exist, or DNE for short. And I use this example to show that limits just don't always exist. There doesn't always have to be a limit. There's plenty of functions that just straight up don't have limits, such as this one. And in future limit videos, we'll talk about continuity and some other things that will show if our function has a limit or not in the first place. But for now, I really hope you enjoyed this calculus lesson. If you're ready to move on to lesson 2, I'll have it linked here. This lesson will go over strategies for solving limits, because sometimes it's not always this easy. Sometimes it takes a little bit more work to figure out what the limit of our function is. Subscribe for more fun math videos, and I will see you guys next time. Peace out.